So in today's class, we are going to discuss coronary detection. Let us first see some motivation, and then we'll go to details of it. One of the example where, or one of the application where this technique can be used is in image registration. So what we basically mean by image registration, in the case of image registration, we have two or more images given, and we want to stitch them to make a larger picture. Okay, as you see in this example, you have two images. One image on the left side is covering some part of a particular scene. The image on the right side is covering some part of a particular scene. And then you want to combine them together to make a bigger picture. Right? And this exactly we do when we create a panoramic image. We take multiple shots, and then we want to stitch them together to get a bigger picture. So in this particular application, let's say, you want to find out what is the portion which is common in the two given images. Right? For example, in this in this case, you see that the portion here in this image here and the portion in this image, they are common to each other. Right? So how will you find out whether they are common or not? So to find out this, we use the approach of some salient points. And later we'll see that these salient points are nothing but the corner points. So when we have these salient points defined on the image, or if these corner points defined on the image, by matching these corner points in the two given images, we can find out whether a particular area or a pixel here in one image is same as in the other image, or it's a new pixel, right? So for example, in this case, if you match all the pixels that are here, or the pixels that are here, you will find that they are actually the same. So if they are same, then when you are creating the patched image, you should actually overlap those regions. If the pixels are new pixels, or the area in the image that that you have, it's a new image, a new area, or the non-common area, then you should actually retain both the areas. If you find that there's something is common, then that can be actually merged in such a way that the common portion is just shown once in the staged image. Okay, so to find out the common portion, we can make use of these salient features, which are nothing but the corners. We will see in the later slides. Another application where you may would like to use this one, this kind of feature detection, and the application is object tracking. In case of object tracking, also when you are tracking the multiple objects. Or even a particular object, when an object moves from one scene to another scene, as you know, the video is nothing but it's a collection of multiple scenes. So when an object is moving from one scene to another scene, you want to find out whether this object, in the new frame, a particular object is same as the one that you had in the previous frame, or it's a different object, or if a particular object was visible in a particular place in a particular scene, where has it gone in the next scene? So if you want to track that, in that case also, in place of tracking all the pixels that are there in the object, we find out these some salient points in the object, and with the help of these salient points, only we track the object. And these salient points we are going to define later as corner points. Okay, so these are the two applications I have mentioned here, but there are several other applications where this kind of approach can be used. So all these salient points that I said, in this particular class, we are going to talk about, we are going to say that they are the corner point, but there are many other such key point, such feature point detectors. Some of the examples I have listed here, like SIFT, SURF, HOG, these are some of the techniques with the help of which you can actually compute this kind of salient points. And there are for these points, there are multiple names. Sometimes we call these points as feature points, or sometimes we call it salient points, or we call them as interest point or key point. There are multiple names for this, but they all refer to some unique points or some salient points on the image. Okay, so corner is one of the corner is one of the example of a feature point or interest point or key point. Other examples of the interest point or key point are SIFT, SURF, HOG, and there are many others. And common applications, some of the applications I have just shown you, But there are other applications also where this kind of features can be used. For example, using these features, you can do object recognition. Similarly, you can do stereo calibration where, like, for example, you have two cameras and then you want to calibrate them. There also you can use this for the robot navigation. The same as tracking. Let's say you are doing the robot navigation. There also, with the help of these feature points or these key points, you can do the navigation. Okay. So in the previous classes, we have seen edge detection. Edge detection was also a kind of salient feature because, if you remember the motivation there also, we have seen that with the help of edges, we can even recognize the objects, right? A lot of things we can do just by using the edges. And edges, in some sense, you can say edges are also unique for every given object. So, for example, if you have to differentiate two class of objects, edges can be very, very useful. If you have to differentiate flower from, let's say, the aeroplane, the edges can be very well used. Right? So they are also a kind of features. Why we are talking about edges here? Because we are going to define corner by taking the example of edges. Or we'll compare edges and corner and we'll see how corners are different from edges. So that is why we are just talking about edges here again. How we have defined the edges in the previous class, this again we are going to use, that's why I'm again reiterating. So we define that edges were the pixels in the image where the image intensity gradient was pi. Okay. And when we do the edge detection, what we get, this the process of edge detection actually converts the given 2D image to a set of curves. And these set of curves, in some sense, represent some kind of salient features of the scene. And edges are the representation of the edge image gives the representation of the representation of a scene in more compact way. So in case of edges, we are saying that the gradient is high in a particular direction. Right? Please remember this one. Now let us first define corner, and then we'll see how we, in terms of gradient, how we define the corner. So in a general sense, we can say that corners are nothing but they are the intersection of two lines. For example, here there you see multiple lines are intersecting. So we can say that this is one corner point, this is another corner point, this is another corner point. Here in this particular scene, we have three corner points. Now, in terms of curvature, we can say that these are the points where the curvature is the highest. If you, let's say, consider this blue curve, which is the combination of these three lines, if you just compute the curvature of each and every point on this blue curve, you'll find that the curvature will be very high at the corner point, okay? Because when there's, you see a bending at that particular point, so obviously the curvature is going to be high. Now, in terms of gradient, if we analyze the gradient of the scene and then see what is going to happen if we compute the gradient at a corner point, we'll see that on the edges, we say that a gradient change happen in one direction, but at the corner, we say that the gradient change actually happens in all the directions. If you just try to compute the gradient at these corners, you will find that the gradient will be actually, the change in the gradient will be available in actually all the directions. Okay. So more details on the corners we are just going to talk about, but let us first differentiate why we are going for the corners. What is the problem with the edges? Because in some sense, edges and corners are based on the gradient, and they are, obviously, as I just said, giving the feature points. But in case of edges, we say that edges face the aperture problem, which basically means that if you just see a small part of one edge and a small part of the another edge, it is very difficult to match the points in those parts of the edges, because the point that you have there, they will be of very similar nature, right? All the points you just see inside this circle, they all are going to be very same. And the another line here in this inside the circle that I've drawn, they are all going to be very same. So if we consider a very small area in the edge image and we try to match the two such small areas, it would be very difficult to establish the point correspondences between the points that you are going to have under these selected areas. Okay? But in case of corner, we don't face this problem, because as you see in this picture, when you take a small area, you will get one corner point. Similarly, if you take another small area in the other image at the corner, you are going to get just one small area. So the matching is going to be easier there. You will not have one to many correspondences as you see here. If you just notice in this example, you have selected some area here, and you are talking about one particular point in this under the selected area up on the edge, and you have multiple matchings with respect to the this particular point on the other edge. Okay, so this particular problem is called the aperture problem, which basically says that if you take a soda straw, which is like which has a very narrow hole, and if you with the help of if you see the two edges, it will be very difficult to match them because you are just talking about a very small region. But if the same thing if you do with respect to corners, you will not face that problem. You can again understand this this concept by this example. So again, here you have two objects here, object one and object two. Let's say you want to match object one to object two, and you have one point here, and this you want to find out to what point in your object two this point matches. So you'll find, you'll see that there are several possibilities. Whatever nature you have for this point, you'll find that even this point also has the same nature, this point also has the same nature, this point also has the same nature. All these four points have the same nature, and even there are so many points in between which are having the same nature. So it is very difficult to take one point from one image and then match to other point on the other image, and particularly when you are talking about a small area, because you will not have enough differentiating features. But this problem will not happen if you are talking about the corner. At the corner, if you take a small area, you will have one corner here, and it will be easy to match this corner on the other image. Okay, so that is why we are preferring corners over the edges, because edges face the aperture problem, as we just said, mentioned, and that is not going to happen in case of corners. So that is why we go for corners in place of edges. Okay. So one of the corner detector that we are going to discuss in this class is the Harris corner detector. It was, as the name suggests, it was given by Harris in 1988. And this is very popular, and you can say in some sense the first corner detector algorithm. Let us now understand how it works. And I'm just again reiterating, we have already understood that the when we refer a corner, in a broader sense, we can assume that that point is going to be the intersection of two lines, right, as I just mentioned in previous slide. So in case of Harris, the Harris suggested the detection of corners with the help of window processing. And this is very similar to what we have been keep doing till now. Even in the edge detection also, we have done window processing. Before that also, we have discussed window processing. So in case of corner detection also, in case of particularly in case of Harris corner detection, to detect the corner, we are going to consider a small window in the image, and this window, I mean, or more precisely, we can say to find out if a particular pixel in your image is a corner or not, we are going to consider a small window, and whatever pixels we have inside the window, we will process them, and then based on that, we will decide whether the point which we are considering is a corner point or not. Okay. And as I mentioned in the previous slide, that this corner is going to be a point where the change in the intensity is going to happen in all the directions. So ideally, we can say that if we are at corner point, if we are shifting a window in any direction, it should give a large change in the intensity if we are at the corner point. Okay. So what will happen? Let us say your corner is here. Let us talk about how many possibilities you may encounter when you are let's say processing this image with the help of window processing. So there's one possibility that where your window lies at, let's say, this particular place where the region is planar region. And before that, you can just note down here that in this image there are three types of pixels. One where you can say the corner is there, or one particular pixel, maybe you can say more precisely, where the corner is there. There are some pixels where the edge is there, and there are some pixels where neither corner nor edge is there. So you can say that those are the pixels where there is no intensity change. Okay. So in this particular example, when you are placing your window at this place, you see that at this particular place, this is a flat region. So you move to any direction, you will not find any change in the intensity, okay? Because you are in a flat region. There's another option where, let's say, your window is lying on this, on the edge. Right, like if you see the animation, there is now a window is moving. So when this window is moving in this particular direction, in which the edge is there, then in this case you will find that there is a change. If your window is moving perpendicular to the edge direction, but there is no change if the window is moving on the edge or in the direction of the edge, then there is no change. What will happen if you are talking about a corner? In the corner, if you are moving, you will find that in either direction you go, you shift your window, you will find that you see some change in the intensity, or you can say significant change in the intensity. If you just take this another example, where let's say you have considered a window where all the pixels which are there inside the region, they all are having same intensity, right? Like that means your window is lying on the flat region. This is another way of understanding this concept. So let's say your window is lying on a flat region, and you are in this particular window, let's say you are computing the change in intensity in X direction and in Y direction. So what basically means, suppose this window contains, let's say this is a 5x5 window. So 5x5 window will have 25 points. So for all those 25 points, let's say you compute IX and IY, change in X direction, change in Y direction. So you will find that you will not find any change in X direction or in Y direction, right? That means IX, if you say, let's say IX and IY, these are the intensity changes in X and Y directions. So then the value of IX and the value of IY for this particular window, for all the pixels which are inside this window, the value will be zero, right? Ideally zero, but maybe because of some variations, you may find some small values. So that is why if you plot all those 25 points, you will get the distribution of the intensities, change in intensities, or the distribution for IX and IY like this, where all these points are actually clustered at 0, 0. Okay, this is going to happen when your window doesn't have any, your window is lying actually on a flat region. But let us consider a case where your window is lying on a is lying at a place where some part of window is actually is containing an edge. Okay, for example, in this case, you see you have a particular edge here like this, right? Because on one side you have white intensity in your window, and another side you have blue intensity in your window. So you are basically in this case, you have put your window at a place where an edge is there. Okay? Now, if you compute the change in intensity IX and IY in this case, what you will find? You will find that when you are, again, let us say this is 5x5 window. So when you are computing this, the value of IX and IY at the place or for the pixels which are lying in this region, again, you will find there is no change. Right, there is no change. Similarly, if you are computing this value of IX and IY for the pixels which are lying on this white region, again, you will find that there will be no change. Right? IX, the value of IX and IY will be zero, or close to zero, you can say. But if you are computing the value of Ix and Iy on the pixels which are lying on this line, you will find that there will be a change. Okay, so if you just plot the values of this Ix and Iy on this Ix Iy plane, you will find that you, in this particular case, you will find two clusters. One set of points, they will be accumulated at 0, 0, and another set of points which will be accumulated at this particular place. And why I am saying that they will be accumulated at this particular place? Because all these points that you are putting here, they all are actually lying on same line. And if they are lying on the same line, then obviously they are going to have the same Ix and same Iy value. The gradient value is going to be same. Okay, so that is why you will find the two clusters in this case. Now, if we take the third possibility where a corner is there, and which is nothing but the intersection of two lines. So you will find a scenario like this. And in this case, if you compute the value of Ix and Iy at all possible pixels that are there inside the window, for these pixels or for these pixels, you will find that the value will be 0, right? So all those pixels will be clustered at 0, 0. Now, but if you are computing the value of Ix and Iy for the pixels which are on this line, okay, you'll find that you will have some value of Ix and Iy. And let's say that value is this value. So all the pixels which are lying on this, let's say on the smaller line, they will all get accumulated here. Similarly, for the other line, maybe you can say that they will all get accumulated at the other cluster. Okay. So if you consider a small window in your image, and if your window lies on a planar region, you will find that all the values, all the Ix, Iy values that you have calculated for the pixels, they will be accumulated at 0, 0. If your window has one line, then you will have two clusters in your this distribution. And if your window lies on the at a place where you have a corner, then in that case you will have this kind of three clusters. Okay, and we'll see that this distribution value will help us in detecting a corner point in any given image. Okay, so let us just briefly discuss some mathematics behind this Harris corner detector, and then we'll come to the steps that are followed to compute this. So as we discussed here at the beginning, that at corner point, if you are shifting your window to any direction, you will find a change, right? Change in the intensity. So let us say you have one point as xy, and from that xy you are shifting your window to a new place, which is x plus u and y plus v, right? So new coordinate. So that means, let's say you have this shifted this window from here to, the window was lying here like this, centered at this xy. Now your window has been shifted to a new location, which has the coordinate, let's say this new location, which has coordinate x plus u, y plus v. That means you have shifted u in this direction and v in this direction. Okay. So one thing is that we have to get this change. What is the change you get in the intensity when you are moving from your xy location to x plus u, y plus v location, right? This is one requirement. And second requirement to show that you are at a corner point, the second requirement is that you have to show that this change is happening whatever value of u and v you take, because u and v is telling you the direction in which you are moving. So for different values of u and v, this window will move at different location around x, y. Okay? So from this equation, the ultimate idea is to show that this particular value EUV, which is actually telling the intensity difference that you get when you move from XY to X plus UY plus U, this will exist in all the directions or for all values of U and V. If that happens, then basically this will tell you the location of the corner. Okay, so as I just mentioned, this is the first one is the intensity at XY, and this particular value is the intensity at the shifted new location. Okay, and there is a window function here. We'll see that we'll use this to assign some weights to these intensities. Or when you are computing in a window, this function will help us in assigning weights to different pixels that you are having in your window. So for example, the pixels, some pixels may have more weightage, some pixels may have less weightage, depending on what importance you give to them. Okay, and the value of this weight W will be, you can say, if it is, let's say, one, if the value of weight W is one, then that means we are giving equal importance to all the pixels that are inside the window. And if you are, let's say, assigning the weights using this kind of Gaussian function, this basically shows that we are giving more weightage to the central pixels compared to the pixels which are on the periphery. Because there are different ways of defining the weights. Now, if you do a little mathematics on this expression and you apply, you expand this using the Taylor series, this expression actually turns out to be this. So you can say that approximate value of EUV when you do the Taylor expansion and then leave the non-significant terms there, then this can be EUV can be equivalently defined as this from the previous expression, where C is nothing but this matrix. Okay, what is this C? C contains the intensity change in X and Y direction at various pixels, and this weight value, which is going to be one if all the pixels have equal importance, or it may be defined using some functions if you want to give different weightages to different functions. Okay. So it turns out that as I just said, that in case of corners, you will have if you see this plot here, we are talking about the distribution of IX and IY on this IX IY plane. In case of edge, you will have only one direction. If you just analyze this distribution, you find that this distribution has a kind of orientation in this particular direction, right? But if you analyze the distribution here, you can by looking at this this distribution, you can say that this particular distribution has this particular plot has this distribution has direct it is distributed in two directions. One, maybe for simplicity, you can say this one is this direction and another is in this direction. It doesn't have just one direction in which the points are defined. Okay, so it turns out that if you do the eigenanalysis of this matrix C, the eigenanalysis of the matrix C can actually tell you in your distribution of gradients, or this distribution of IX and IY, what are the dominant directions in which the data is distributed? And what is the data that we are talking about here? It is just the gradient in X direction and gradient in Y direction. C matrix contains all those values. So if we just do the eigenanalysis, and what exactly we mean by eigenanalysis, I'm just going to talk about that in the next slide. So it turns out that if you do the eigenanalysis of this matrix C, from that analysis, we can find out the directions or the dominant directions in which the data distribution is there in the distribution that you have or that you have considered. So for example, here in this case, you have IX, and C matrix contains the gradients, the values of gradients. So by analyzing or by doing the eigenanalysis of this matrix C, we can find out what are the directions in which this gradient is distributed. And as we discussed in the previous slide, that in case of corner, you will have two dominant directions in which the gradient is going to be distributed. In case of edge, you are going to have only one direction in which the distribution is going to happen. Okay, so in case of eigenanalysis, in general, if you have any given distribution like this, let's say these data points are, in our case, in general, we can say that this is feature one and feature two, and with the help of these two features, all these points are defined. Another example you can take, that this is telling you the value of x and this is telling you the value of y, or as we are using in our case, this, you can assume that this is ix and this is iy. So for these variables, let's say by using the values assigning the values to these variables, let's say these points have been defined, and when they are plotted, their distribution looks like this. So if we just consider these values, here are the coordinates of these points that you have here, and if you do the eigenanalysis, which is also sometimes called the principal component analysis, this analysis is actually going to do, and as you see here, you can assume that this is going, I mean, if you just collectively keep the values of x and y coordinates of these pixels, you are going to get a matrix. So if you just do the eigenanalysis of the covariance matrix of that data matrix, that analysis is going to give you two eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2, and corresponding to those two eigenvalues, it is going to give you two eigenvectors, v1 and v2. Out of these two eigenvalues, we can assume that one is larger compared to the another one. So whatever is larger corresponding to that, you will find a vector which is telling you the direction of the highest data distribution. So you see that in this particular plot, the data distribution is, or the change, I mean, the distribution has a direction in this. The change is happening more in this direction, and change is happening, there's another direction which is corresponding to lambda 2. The change is happening in the comparatively lesser. Okay. So in our case also, as we are talking about a general case here, where we have the x, y points are feature 1, feature 2. In our case, these points are nothing but the value, these points are obtained by using the value ix and iy. So if you just do the eigenanalysis of this data distribution, you can find out these dominant directions. And in case of edge, as I just said here, that this lambda 1 is more than lambda 2. So whatever the direction you are getting corresponding to lambda 1, that will tell you that the direction of the highest variation. And the smaller one give you the direction of the least variation, actually. So in case of edge, as you see, and one more thing you can note down from here is that the value of lambda is proportional to the change or the variation that you see in that particular direction. So for example, if the lambda is very high, you can say that the direction in which you are, the corresponding vector that you are getting, in that direction you have high variance in your data. If the lambda is small, then you can say the vector that you are getting corresponding to that lambda in that direction, the variation is data variation is less. So if you just apply this notion on our distribution of ix and iy values, then you find that in case of edges, you will have a very high one of the lambda, but the another lambda will be quite small, because in this case, whatever the distribution or whatever the variations you are having, that is more in this direction, very less variation you have in this direction. But in case of corner, whatever the two directions you are going to get, in both the directions the distribution is, or the variation in the data is going to happen. So by analyzing the values of lambda 1 and lambda 2 that you are going to get when you are going to do the eigenanalysis of this data, you can actually find out whether a point is a corner point or it's not a corner point. And just very briefly, let us see what we mean by eigenanalysis. So if you have data, let us say given as D, the data matrix will be always, in this case, when you are talking about the 2D data, this is going to be a matrix of size n cross 2, where you have n features or n rows, and every row is represented by using two values. So from this D matrix, if you compute the covariance matrix, and let's say that covariance matrix is sigma, and do its eigen decomposition or do its principal component analysis, you will find that this matrix can be decomposed or can be written like this, where so actually this the covariance matrix we are considering here is C. So this matrix C can be written like this, C equal to X inverse sigma X, where this sigma is going to contain the sigma is going to be a diagonal matrix, and it is going to contain only the values of these eigen values, which are lambda 1 and lambda 2. Other values, this is going to be a 2 cross 2 matrix, and it is a diagonal matrix, so other two values, only diagonal values have non-zero value, and other two values are zero. And similarly, this X here is going to contain eigenvectors corresponding to these eigenvalues. Okay. So we are interested at this moment, we are interested only in sigma, or more precisely on the values lambda 1 and lambda 2 that you have in sigma. So for given data D, if you get this matrix C from that, which we have already defined in the previous slide, so if you do the eigen decomposition of value C, you can decompose it as C equal to X inverse sigma X, and if you just see the values of lambda that you have in sigma, analyzing those values, we can define the corners. Just to have a ready reference, I'm just again writing your C matrix here, which is nothing but the collection of the intensities that you have, change in intensity that you have in X and Y directions at various pixels. Okay. And please remember, this particular matrix is being calculated at XY. That means the window that you have used that is centered at XY. But in this particular window, you may have multiple points. So this IX, when you are saying sigma IX square, so this is basically you are summing the change in intensity in X direction for all the pixels that you have in this window. Okay. And whatever you are going to get overall is going to define the matrix C for pixel XY. And then for that, you are going to do the eigen decomposition. And whatever outcome you are going to get from this analysis, that is going to tell whether this particular point XY where we have considered this window, that point is going to be a corner point or not. Okay. This is one of the simple case where, let us say your edges are oriented like this, or your corner is defined like this, where this is the intersection of two horizontal and vertical lines. You will find that when you are computing the gradient, one of the value IX or IY will be zero everywhere. So if you put those values here, you will find that this matrix is nothing but this matrix, where these values are zero because they are the product of IX and IY, and every place either IX is zero or IY is zero, and you will have lambda 1 and lambda 2. So I mean, this is a very simple case where if you are doing the eigen decomposition of C, you are in your sigma matrix, you are going to get this lambda 1. Your sigma matrix is actually going to be something like this. Now, by analyzing, as is mentioned, by analyzing the value of sigma 1 and sigma 2, we can find out whether a particular point is a corner point or it's an edge point. So as I just mentioned, if you have one of the sigma as zero, one of the sigma is non-zero, and another sigma is, this is lambda. So one of the lambda is zero and another lambda is non-zero. Okay? Or we can say that one of the lambda is close to zero and another lambda has a non-zero value. So that will be the case which basically tells that the distribution is only in one direction, and that is the case where the edge exists. Okay. If you find that the lambda 1 and lambda 2 both are zero, that will basically define the interior region. But at corner point, as we discussed, at the corner point in your 2D data, 2D distribution of these intensity changes, you will have two dominant directions. So that means the value of both lambda 1 and lambda 2, it will be non-zero. And we will also see later that this is going to be, I mean, these lambda 1 and lambda 2 are going also going to have high values. If you just put the various possibilities of this lambda 1 and lambda 2, we can say that whatever lies in this particular region, that will define the corner. That means all the values, I mean, this axis is lambda 1, this axis is lambda 2. So all the values that you have here in this particular region, here the lambda 1 and lambda 2 are non-zero and they are significantly large. So all the possible lambda 1 and lambda 2 that lies in this region, they will define the corner. Similarly, if your lambda 1 and lambda 2 lies on this in this particular region where one of the lambda is big and another lambda is small, so then that will define edge. So this will happen here and here. In this particular case, lambda 2 is larger than very large compared to lambda 1, and in this case lambda 1 is quite large too, large compared to the lambda 2. So this any lambda 1 lambda 2 that lies here, that will define the edge. And if you have lambda 1 lambda 2 lying in this region which is close to 0 0, that this basically tells that the values of lambda 1 and lambda 2 are either 0 or they are close to 0. So that will, if you have this case or if you have any case where lambda 1 and lambda 2 are close to 0 or lambda 1 and lambda 2 are lying in this particular region, then you can say that they are the interior pixels in your window that you have considered, or that those are the pixels where neither edge nor corner is there. Okay. With respect to this matrix, the simplified matrix that we just discussed here, where the corner is created by intersection of two horizontal and vertical lines, you can have a generic case where you can say that this matrix C is nothing but it is like it is defined by rotating whatever value you have for this matrix by R, and then again by performing the inverse rotation so that you can again come back to the original domain. Okay, this is just alternate way of defining a generalized case with the help of the case that we are having here. Okay. So now let us summarize the whole process of corner detection. If your image is a noisy image, the first thing that we need to do is to reduce the noise in the image. So for that we can use Gaussian filtering. Once the Gaussian filtering is done and your the noise is removed from the image, then we can go for the computation of intensity change in x and y direction. And please remember, this whole computation is being done with respect to a particular point where we are checking the possibility of this point being corner point or not. So let us say this point is xy, and this particular xy we are trying to find out whether this point is a corner point or not. So for this we have already removed the noise. That this noise removal, you can consider that we have done on the whole image, and then after that at a particular point xy we have considered a window, and then we are computing ix and iy. Okay, and for faster computation, one more thing you can do. Since Ix and Iy is going to be computed at each and every pixel, you can also compute Ix and Iy for all the pixels in one go. Okay, like you have done noise removal for the entire image, similarly for the entire pixels that you have in your image, you can just do I computation of Ix and Iy, and you can create two matrices, and wherever those values are required, you can just directly refer to those matrices. This will actually avoid repeated computation. So let us say you have removed the noise from your image, and you have also computed Ix and Iy from your image. You have computed Ix and Iy for your all the pixels of your image. Then to compute whether xy is a corner pixel or not, you have to consider this matrix C that we discussed in the previous slide. So to compute this matrix C around xy, let us say we have considered a small window, and in that window whatever the pixels are lying corresponding to those pixels, we are summing the values of change in intensity change in x direction for all those pixels. We are keeping that value here. Similarly, we are multiplying the change in x direction and change in y direction for all the pixels, and then summing and keeping that value here. And similarly, with the help of Ix and Iy, we are computing this value, and with the help of Iy, we are computing this value and creating this matrix C. Now, once the C matrix is calculated, then based on discussion that we had, we can find out whether this particular XY is a corner point or not. And one more thing, in the previous definitions where we have defined C, we also used a window W. So that W is not written here, but you can also write a W here. And that W can be a Gaussian window, which basically mean that when you are associating the values from this, from all these pixels that you have in this region, or when you are associating the values of IX and IY for the pixels which are in this region, you are giving more importance to the pixels which are close to the central pixel, and you are giving lesser and lesser importance to the pixels which are far farther and farther from the central pixel. Okay, so that is basically this mean that using a Gaussian window. Whenever you say you are using a Gaussian window, this basically mean central pixel is given more importance, and as you move away from the central pixels, the pixels are giving lesser and lesser importance. Okay, so we can have a Gaussian window here. Okay. Once you have the Gaussian window, once you have defined the matrix C, you can define the values of you can do the eigen decomposition, and you can get the values of lambda. And as I just mentioned, in case of high risk corner detection, we are looking for the places where the lambda is high. Both lambdas are high. So basically, whatever outcome we are going to get from here, we are going to analyze the values of lambda, and we're going to check whether they are both high or not. And one more thing Harris does in the Harris current detection it is done, it actually also checks that the ratio of those two lambdas is not very high. This basically ensures that both the lambdas are big as well as they have the same value. Okay? When you are saying that the ratio of is not too big, that means they are close to each other. Then only you can say that the ratio is not too big. So there are two things that are looked here. That are basically checked. One, that both the lambdas are big, and second, both the lambdas have similar kind of values. Okay, so Harris has actually combined what we have discussed here. To combine that, Harris has actually given a response calculator function, which is defined here like this, which says that this response R is equal to lambda 1 into lambda 2 minus k times lambda 1 plus lambda 2 whole square, where this k is a constant which can be empirically chosen, and the range of the k which is taken here is this. It lies between 0.04 to 0.06. Okay, and this equation can be alternatively written like this, because this lambda 1 and lambda 2 is nothing but the determinant of matrix C, because you know, if you just see these matrices, I mean, if you remember, you have a diagonal matrix there where you have diagonal values 0, 0, and lambda 1 and lambda 2, and non-diagonal values are 0. So we can say that this lambda 1 into lambda 2 is nothing but the determinant of C. But please remember, when we are saying this, we are actually talking about this kind of definition of C, okay, not this one. Yeah, just please differentiate, where we are saying that initially we had the lambda one, this kind of matrix for the simplest case, and we said that this can be a generalized case can be created by using this matrix if we consider that these two rotation matrix, one rotation matrix and the another the inverse rotation matrix. Okay, so if you have denoted your C like this, your C is this matrix, then actually we can say that this value, this lambda 1 into lambda 2 is nothing but the determinant of C. And similarly, if you have only in your C, if you have just lambda 1 and lambda 2, then its trace will be lambda 1 plus lambda 2. So alternatively, you can write this equation. Okay, and once this response is calculated, so whatever we have discussed in this particular point, that can be collectively computed with the help of this expression. So we can say that to find out if a pixel is corner pixel or not, we have to just calculate the value of this response function. And if in your entire image, if you want to find out the pixels which are corner pixels or the pixels which are not the corner pixels, you have to compute this response for all the pixels. And once you have computed the response for all the pixels, we will see that we will require a kind of thresholding and non-maximum suppression to find out the pixels where this response is high in a local neighborhood. Okay, this you will understand when I show you the example. I have one example here. Before that, if you just plot the value of this function R, it looks like this. So here on this axis you have lambda 1, on this axis you have lambda 2, and if you consider various possibilities of lambda 1 and lambda 2, and if you plot the value of R, you find that you get a curves, these yellow curves. So for, let's say, you can say that for R equal to 65, you get a particular curve here. Similarly, or maybe in particular region, you have the value of R equal to 65. Similarly, here in this particular region, you have R equal to 28. So it turns out that when you have this, the value of R equal to R less than zero, this basically corresponds to the case where either lambda 1 or lambda 2 is very high, other is small. So that, in terms of the region, you can say that that is represented by using this, either this region or in this region. So in these regions, we see that the value of R is negative. There is some region where the value of R is equal to zero, and there are some regions where the value of R equal to R is some high value, non-zero value, and a positive high value. So wherever this R is large, this basically corresponds to the lambdas which are high, or this corresponds to the places where both the lambdas are high. And you can notice that here, wherever these R has high value, you are basically you are towards the corner, right? So for example, in this particular area, you can say that the value of R is high. So this particular, in this particular case, the both lambda 1 and lambda 2 are also high. Similarly, as you move towards this 0, 0, you say you can notice that lambda 1 and lambda 2 will decrease. So when you have by analyzing the value of the plots here, or the value of R here, you can say whether a particular pixel is a corner pixel or it's an edge pixel. So if you plot that here, it turns out that for edge pixels, the value of R is less than zero, right? So all the for all the edge pixels, the value, whatever value of R you are going to get, you will get all those values here. They will be negative value, basically R less than zero. For the corner, the value of R is going to be positive. And similarly, this side also is telling the another possibility where one of the lambda which was zero here is now large. So in these two cases, you have you are going to get edge. In this region, you are going to get corner, and in the flat region, this will define the place where the both lambda 1 and lambda 2 are small, and this will define the flat region. Okay, so by just computing the value of this R and doing the thresholding, you can actually decide the corner and non-corner point. You don't need to actually analyze the lambda 1 and lambda 2 separately, right? And that is why the this collective response function has been given here. So just by using the values of lambda 1 and lambda 2, you calculate the value of R, and then on that R, you can just put a threshold to define whether that particular R is large enough for you or not. And based on that, you can get the possible corner and non-corner points. Okay, let us see this example. I hope this will make the things more clear. So let's say in this example, you want to find out the corner points. So what is the first thing that you need to do to compute the corner points? You compute the all the lambdas at all possible places, and then finally you have to basically compute the value of R. So let's say the value of R has been computed for all these images, and that has been plotted here. Okay, this color has been just shown for the better clarity, but these are the you can assume that they are the grayscale images. On this image, to find out whether the response is large enough or not, we are doing the thresholding. So wherever the R is more than a particular threshold that we have chosen, those points actually corresponds to the possible corner points. We are not saying that they are the corner point, they are the possible corner points. Why we are saying that they are the possible corner points? Because in a, when we are doing the thresholding, we have got many points where the R was more than the threshold, but out in a particular region, you will find that the response of the value of R will be high for a particular pixel, and all the other pixels will be less than that particular value. So to find out in a particular region, what is the point which has the maximum value of R, and that we'll see that later, that point where the local maxima exists for R, that will correspond to our corner point. So to detect that local maxima point, after computing, after doing this thresholding, we do non-maximum suppression, okay, to compute the local maxima. If you remember, if you remember, we also talked about non-maximum suppression in case of canny edge detection, and in there also the output of the non-maximum suppression was the points. So here also, when you do the non-maximum suppression on this image, you get these points. And now please remember, we are not going to do non-maximum suppression by using the values that you are seeing here, because they are just binary values, 0 or 1. When we are going to perform the non-maximum suppression, these white points are going to actually help us in finding out the possible points where we should look for the maxima. Because all the black points are, anyway, they have very low value of R, so they have been suppressed. So only the white points are the points where you may have a corner. So from this image, we are just going to identify points where we should check whether the value of R is a maxima or a local maxima or not. Okay, so please don't get confused that this is a binary image and how we are going to perform the non-maximum suppression. Non-maximum suppression, in some sense, we are going to perform on this image only, on this image only. But at what point you have to perform here this, what are the possible point where you should check the possibility of maxima, that is actually defined by these binary points, because they all satisfy this criteria of that we have set here with based on the threshold. Okay, so based on that, when you do the non-maximum suppression, we get this point, and these are nothing but the corner points. Okay, there are a few other examples where intuitively you can find out that the corner points are existing. These are the geometric shapes. So here, you can very easily say that there's some corner points, and when you do the corner point detection, they have been identified. Similarly, in this image also, you have some corner points. In this example also, like for example, here you have a corner, so a corner point is detected. In this case also, the corner point is detected. And originally, this Harris corner was actually detected for motion tracking. And when this was used for motion tracking, this drastically reduces the computation of computing the pixel correspondences between the two consecutive frames. Because when we represent our frames, not with the help of every pixel, but with the help of some salient feature points or some corner points, then the amount of computation actually gets reduced. So with the help of these corner points, when you are doing tracking, the computation is highly reduced compared to the tracking using every pixel of the frames that you have in your video. The highest corner point detection algorithm is invariant to translation and rotation. I think this is intuitive. Very easily it can be seen from the from our discussion, but this is not invariant to scale. Okay, so this basically means that if your object is a let's say has in your image, let's say the size of the object is 20 pixel cross 20 pixel, yeah, and if you enlarge your image and you your size of the object, let's say because of that enlargement, becomes 40 cross 40, then the points that you have earlier as corner point, they may not still exist as corner point. So it is not a scale invariant. With respect to this example, if you take this example here, if this picture here, and let's say make the size as double, so whatever the whatever pixels you are going to get here as corner pixels, you may not get the same pixels as corner pixel in the enlarged image. Okay, so that is why it is not a scale invariant. There's just one slide, last slide. There's another kernel detection method, or more precisely, we can say the key point detection method. It is based on the Hessian matrix, and Hessian matrix is nothing but the matrix created by change in intensities in x and y direction. But here, in place of using the first derivative, we are taking the second derivative. Earlier, we have used Ix and Iy, but here we are using Lxx or Lxy. Lxx means you are taking the second, computing the intensity difference in x direction twice. It means a double derivative. In this case, when you are saying xy, that means at a particular place, you have computed first the derivative in x direction, and then you are computing the derivative in the y direction. Okay, so those values, when you put collectively here in case of 2D as 2 cross 2 matrix, this matrix is called the Hessian matrix. And it turns out that if you just analyze the determinant of this matrix, that also can help us in finding out the key points. And here, the places where this determinant is high, that actually those points corresponds to key points. Okay, so with this, let us conclude this class.